Hello and welcome to today's episode of Music with Tony Toppi. Today we're going to be looking at analysis, and this will be part four in the series, and we'll be focusing on texture. So why is analysis important, and why is it? Why do we have to do it? And this is something that I have mentioned in previous parts to this series, so please feel free to go back and have a look at parts 1 through 3 for some detailed explanations of these points. But suffice to say, probably the most important reason why we analyze music in this particular way is to help improve our own performance skills. Of course, we're always listening to music with some sort of idea of assessing the expressive outcome. What is the performer or what is the music trying to communicate to us through their treatment of dynamics, tone, color, articulation, texture, etc., etc.? So simply put, all analysis questions will ask you to identify certain elements of music and discuss how they affect the expressive outcome. So, texture, what is it? You'll see a picture of a birthday cake there, and I'll reveal what that's all about in a moment. Texture is the layers of music, all the different parts like the accompaniment, the rhythm, the melody, the harmony, etc. And the analogy of a cake is probably the most clear way to understand this. Most cakes are made with layers. There'll be a base, there'll be a middle icing on the top, for example, or some sort of cream, and then we have, you know, candles, for example, for a birthday or some other sort of festive occasion. And that's how we can describe the layers of music. What's down the bottom supporting the music, what's in the middle that's going to enhance that support, and then the melody, which is like the icing on top. So we talk about the balance of musical lines. That's the balance of all of those parts. I have just spoken about the bottom, the accompaniments, for example, in the background. Then we have the middle ground area, which is the harmony, and the foreground area, which is what you usually hear most prominently and usually is the melody. We have a few different ways, depending on how composers arrange those parts, those layers. We have a thing called monophony, or monophonic for the adjective. And that's when you have a single line melody. It could be like a Gregorian chant, which had a single voice, a single melody being sung, or perhaps a solo violin piece, something like that, or a solo flute piece. Then we have homophony, or homophonic for the adjective, which is a melody and an accompaniment. A very clear soloist and accompanying figures. Could be just basic chords, could just be some sort of repetitive thing underneath. It could almost be like a concerto, where you have a soloist out the front and then the orchestra is accompanying, but that's a bit of a grey area. Then we have polyphony, or polyphonic music, and that's when you have many independent melodies occurring at the same time, usually will have equal importance. We have antiphony, or antiphonic music, and that's like a call and response, very prominent in gospel music, where someone will sing a line and then the rest of the congregation will respond with some sort of refrain that is repeated throughout the whole song. Then we have heterophony, or heterophonic music, which is similar to monophony, where we have a single melody, but it's played by multiple instruments or voices, but each of those instruments or voices uses their own sorts of ornamentations or embellishments to enhance that single line melody. Of course, we want to talk about the role of each instrument within the overall texture. So literally identifying what is playing the melody, what is in the middle ground on the harmony, and what's in the background on the accompaniment or rhythm or support underneath. But going on from that, we talk about the blend of instrumental voices. And here we talk about the combination of things like tone colours, dynamics, articulations, phrasing. How do each of those instrumental voices contribute to each other? Is it in a homogeneous way, meaning they match the dynamics, they match in tone colour, they match somewhat in articulation and phrasing? Or is it disparately in a way that's completely different, or a mixture of different tone colours and dynamics and articulations, etc. Of course, as you're talking about all this, you're always referring back to the expressive outcome. There's no reason that people perform music unless to communicate something or to have some sort of expression there. So that's a bit of a background on texture. Let's launch straight into a piece of music, and one of my favourites, the Ballad of Sweeney Todd from the musical Sweeney Todd, written by Stephen Sondheim. This is a particularly great piece for many, many reasons, but in no small part because of Sondheim's use of texture, both within the vocal parts and within the accompanying orchestral parts as well. I'll play the music through once, and I won't talk over the top of it, but I want you just to follow the words, and normally you wouldn't have the words in an exam situation, but for the purposes of illustrating the different sections and illustrating the different textures, I'm going to use the words. So have a listen and see what you can hear and how many different layers of music you can hear in each section. So we'll be listening to the Ballad of Sweeney Todd from the musical Sweeney Todd, and it's the original Broadway cast recording.
Attend the tale of Sweeney Todd. His skin was pale and his eye was odd. He shaved the faces of gentlemen who never thereafter were heard of again. He trod a path that few have trod, did Sweeney Todd, the demon barber of Fleet Street. He kept a shop in London town of fancy clients and good renown. And what if none of their souls were saved? They went to their maker impeccably shaved. By Sweeney Todd, the demon barber of Fleet Street.
What an incredible bit of music and an incredible way to open a musical. It's just such a great power, a great sense of building and suspense through that piece, and starts very soft and brooding and then ends in a very similar way, except for that, you know, simple xylophone line, low strings, and then a big crash at the end. It just takes you on a great journey, which is basically what the musical is, a huge journey of ups and downs and franticness and chaos, etc. Okay, so let's get into this. I will play it again, and I'm going to talk over the top, but let's have a look at the opening and talk about how Sondheim uses voice and orchestra together. So here we go. So this opening section, homophonic in texture, we're going to have a soloist and accompaniment. We have low strings and woodwind in the accompaniment. The baritone voice singing solo. It's a rather homogenous tone colour. So we're all similar range, similar area of our instruments, sounding very the same. And it's a very brooding opening, a very brooding expression. The next section, thicker texture. We have a tenor voice on the solo. We have a counter melody. The counter melody played by high woodwinds and violin. Makes it a bit eerie, a bit uncomfortable. By Sweeney Todd, the demon bomber of Fleet Street. And the biggest part of the song. Swing your razor wide, Sweeney, pull into the sky. The thickest texture. It's homophonic voices, increase of dynamics, homogeneous tone color, and very grand. And then he brings it right back down to here. The similar texture to the second stanza, but now we're alternating between high and low voices. We get a suspenseful character here. We're moving, we're not quite sure where we're going, who's singing, who's the solo, what's going to happen. Complete change. Thinner texture, higher voices and instruments. They're still homogeneous. Everyone is sitting in their same range. Very creepy. And here's the exciting bit. Layering of lines, polyphonic texture, increased dynamics. The disparate tone colours, nothing's quite matching. Very frantic. And then we have an antiphonal texture. A response. Another call. A response. Homogeneous, we're sounding like a unified ensemble, and it has some sort of religious element to it. Then we end with a homophonic texture back to our melody and accompaniment and giving us this brooding sense to end with again. So such an exciting bit of music. It goes through literally 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 expressions in about 3.5 minutes. What an exciting way to open a musical. I'll just quickly talk through again those little sections. So we open with this homophonic section, the role of these instruments, the orchestra very much accompanying. There's a hint sometimes of a muted trumpet that comes in every now and then, which is sort of just outlining bits of harmony. So it's sort of sitting there in the middle ground. And of course, the voice sitting up there in the foreground with our melody. Homogeneous tone color, we're all sort of matching, gives this really brooding effect. The thicker texture in the next part, thicker purely for the fact that we've now added some instruments on top, the counter melody of the high woodwind and violins, almost reminiscent of the music from the movie Psycho, with very high, almost harmonics on the stringed instruments. This middle section, the swing your razor wide, Sweeney, huge, very choral, homophonic voices, homogeneous tone color. It's as if they're just a choir singing a piece of choral music. Increased dynamics because the entire company plus orchestra are singing, and it's just such a powerful moment where everything comes together. But then it breaks away very soon thereafter into the next verse. We get this suspenseful character. So it's similar to the section that starts, "He kept a shop in London town." That this next section, his needs were few, his room was bare, we get the suspense because we have the changes of texture, the changes of tone color, and the changes of who's singing what and when. And we have that counter melody back again. The next section, we have those higher voices coming in, so the sopranos singing quite high and shrill in their top register, together with the higher instruments, together with I think it's a double bass playing in its higher register. Triangle comes in. So everything is now starting to match the voices. And it's quite creepy because it sort of still does a little of alternating between different textures and tone colours. The polyphonic section, this polyphonic texture, and very exciting part. Text from earlier on in the song, text from now, is all interweaving, and very disparate tone colours increase the dynamics, creates a very frantic mood. Then, as I said before, the antiphonal texture, almost religious, and we get back to that choral sound that he was using earlier on. And then we end with a homophonic, brooding expression that we had right at the beginning. So do yourself a favour, go away and actually have a listen to that again, see if you can find the DVD of it, and actually watch what happens on stage. There are some really interesting and fun ways that this has been staged as well, and also helps understand the texture of the music a bit more. So that's my little analysis of the Ballad of Sweeney Todd. Here are some further listening activities for you to do. Ravel's Bolero, a great exercise, a compositional exercise by Ravel, which then became a standard concert piece, where he just explores different tone colours of the orchestra and different textures within the orchestra. It's about a quarter of an hour long, but an excellent performance of it would make that quarter of an hour go really quickly. We have the Tonight Quintet from West Side Story towards the end of Act 1, another one similar to the Ballad of Sweeney Todd, the use of voices and orchestra in different ways and textures and tone colours. The Hallelujah Chorus from Handel's Messiah, what an excellent one for looking at texture and how a composer of the Baroque era would go through different textures. And lastly, One Day More from Les Miserables, the musical, towards the end of Act 1, similar to Tonight Quintet and to the Ballad of Sweeney Todd, how the use of voices and orchestra have different textures and tone colours. So if you have any further questions, queries or comments, please feel free to contact me at tonytoppi@me.com.